solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock.
Church, it's good to see you this morning. If you would stand with us as we worship.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Pleasant Hill. We're glad that you're here, and we're glad we get to start this new year off together. If you have the bulletin, there's a few things I want to let you know about that are coming up. And one of the biggest starts today, and we've been talking about it for about the last month or so, and that is Core 52. Core 52 is going to be a program that leads us throughout all of this next year. And it's really neat because we'll be kicking each week off together in this service and downstairs in Children's Church with our weekly theme. And then on Monday at home, you can read the devotion for that week in the Core 52 book. There's also a book for teenagers and a book for families. And then on Tuesday, we're all going to be working on a memory verse together. On Wednesday, you'll be reading a little bit of a longer passage, and on Thursday, you'll be reading a couple shorter passages, and all that's based on the same theme each week. It's a chance for us to look at some of the biggest themes in the Bible, but it's also a really good chance for us as a church family to grow together and to build up our knowledge and to grow in our faith as we spend time in God's Word. So we really hope that you will join us on this journey. There's a couple of parts of that. In the foyer, you'll see the books, the Core 52 book, and we had somebody come in and just pay for the rest of them. So if you do not have one, please take one today. If you have a teenager, be sure to grab the teen book. On Wednesday nights, we'll be doing a small group material with our teenagers. And then you'll also see the family book there. Another aspect of this is each week we'll be sending out an email that will have a short teaching video and a short video to help you memorize that week's verse. And we would love to make sure that you get that video. So if you have not been receiving the church emails, or you've never received the church emails, if you look inside your bulletin, you'll see this big QR code. If you scan that, that will take you to a page where you can sign up for those church emails, because we definitely don't want you to miss out on those. One of the aspects of those weekly Core 52 emails is Mark Moore, who put the devotions together here, has about a 5 to 8 minute weekly teaching video. And it'll help us even go more in depth into what we're learning about that week. So please be sure to scan that. We'll have our first email going out sometime tomorrow morning. And we definitely want to make sure that you are part of that. If you have any questions about it, please let me know. And we'll try to do our best to answer those questions for you. Today at 6 o'clock, our young adult group will be meeting. And instead of meeting over at our house, we're actually going to meet downstairs in the fellowship hall. This is kind of our belated Christmas party that we're having. You'll see the information in the bulletin. And if you have any questions, just let us know. Wednesday night, our Wednesday night dinners and youth group classes are back. Dinner starts at 6 o'clock. And then we have classes for every age starting at 7. And that's from nursery on up. Our adult class options this year, or at least for right now, our Core 52. It's the small group study that goes along with what we're going to be doing. And that's taught by Harley Myers at 7 o'clock right inside here. And then at 7 o'clock down in our adult classroom is the Gospel Unleashed. And Joey Bird and Rick Patterson will be teaming up on that. And that covers Acts chapters 1 through 9. And again, we'd love to see you get plugged into one of those classes. This Saturday at 7:30 in the morning is our men's breakfast. We enjoy a great meal and then a devotion on the book of James as we work through that, then followed up by just some great discussion and prayer. So all guys, we invite you to come out, bring your sons, your grandsons with you, and we usually wrap up a little bit before 8:30. So please plan on coming and joining us. You'll see a lot of other things that are coming up over the next couple of weeks. You'll see a big advertisement for the Change in Paces small group. They would love for you to come and join that home Bible study. Meets next week on Sunday evening at the Hunt's house. And as you look through there, if you have any questions, please let us know. But this time, will you please stand and join me as we open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, what a blessing it is to be able to start a new year. And in doing so, we realize that there's always new opportunities. There's opportunities for us to grow, to become more like you. And we pray that you will guide us through this next year. We pray that over this next year, as a church family, that we'll just grow closer to you, that we'll build up our knowledge of who you are, and that we will just desire to walk with you in all that we do. We thank you that you're a mighty God who saves us. And we thank you for the opportunity that we have now to sing praises to you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
more praise.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Thank you for your beauty, the beauty of this world that we live in, the beauty of the blessings that you send, and the beauty of being able to know you. I pray this morning that as we open up your word and as we start this journey, that we will take what you would have us hear, apply it to our lives, and live our lives 100% for you. We love you and we praise you in your mighty name. Amen. You may be seated.
If you have ever stood on a mountaintop, you've seen it. Or fished in a river, or sat on the edge of a canyon, you've seen it. If you visited a zoo, or held a newborn baby, you've seen it. If you've watched a tree as those leaves change colors, or you have seen a sunrise or a sunset, you've seen it. If you swam in the ocean, or stood when snowflakes are falling all around you, you've seen it. Matter of fact, not only have you seen it, you've probably snapped a picture of it and maybe told somebody about it. You see, all around us constantly, we see the beauty of God's creation. that the world in which God has created for us is just incredible. And the more we see it, the more we discover it, the more that we admire it. It's hard to deny. And why would we ever want to, that God has created a world full of beauty? And as we begin this Core 52 series, we do so by looking at the beginning of this beautiful world we live in. Now, usually when we look at Genesis chapter 1, we do a couple of different things. Sometimes when we begin Genesis chapter 1, we kind of lump it in with Genesis 2 and 3, and we just kind of run through the Garden of Eden pretty quickly. Or sometimes we just focus on the days of creation. Maybe if you grew up in church or Sunday school, VBS, you learn the days of creation with posters and flannel graphs and different cubes or maybe songs that take you through each of these days. And a lot of times when we look at these moments of creation, we marvel at what God has created. But today I want us to approach Genesis 1 maybe a little bit differently than normally. You see, a lot of times when we begin to go through God's Word, we notice the characters, the stories. But if we're not careful, sometimes we forget, in the midst of focusing on all these little parts, that the Bible is God's story. And the Bible reveals God to us. And through every story, every encounter, every character, we learn more about God, His power, His plans, His purpose. But sometimes in the midst of all these small pieces, we forget. It's kind of like going to an art gallery and seeing all the art spread out all around you, and you admire the art, but you forget that behind that art is an artist. Well, this morning, our goal is to step beyond just what God has created, but to really see how God's creation reveals the beauty of who God is. To do so, we're going to spend a little bit of time today in the book of Genesis chapter 1, if you want to flip over to that or punch it up on your phone. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 1. I want to start by reading just the first couple of verses. Moses writes this: "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters." Right away, as we begin to read this account of creation, one of the very first things that we have to notice, and we're just going to do so briefly today, is that there is beauty in the unity of God. Now, the reason we're only going to spend just a couple seconds on this is because our reading this week is going to really focus on the unity of creation. That at the very beginning, we find God, who is three persons, manifested three persons, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, all there active in creation. We see it in verse 2, it says, "Now the earth was formed and empty," there's nothing there, "and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters." We see the Holy Spirit right there, the beginning of creation. In John chapter 1, verse 1, in talking about the Savior coming to earth, it says, "In the beginning was the Word." The Word is Jesus, and it tells us that He was there in the beginning. But not only was Jesus there in the beginning, it goes on and tells us that the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through Him all things were made, and without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. We see at the very beginning of creation that God manifested through the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, all there, all active. It's why in Genesis 1:26 we find the words, "Then God said, let us make man in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish and the sea and the birds and the sky, over the livestock and the wild animals, and over all the creation that moves along the ground." The very beginning, one of the most beautiful things we see about creation is the unity in which God created it. And this week, we're going to dig into that a lot more. But let's move forward a little bit and look at the beauty in God's presence. Now, a lot of times when we think about creation, we think about the world that He's created all around us. But if somehow we could take away the oceans we swim in, the rivers that go by us, the birds, the fish, the streams, the mountains, if everything that has been created goes away, we still have the Creator. God is eternal. And not only is He eternal, He is above all creation, and God has existed before creation. It's why it tells us that in the beginning, God. That God has always been there, and God will always be there. James Smith, who wrote a commentary on the Pentateuch, says this in Genesis 1:1. He says, as the curtain of revelation rises to reveal a single actor on a cosmic stage, the spotlight in this verse and throughout this chapter is on God. In the creation narrative, the emphasis is not so much on how as on who. And Genesis begins by declaring the who for us. God is there. And it tells us that he is Elohim. It is a name used for God throughout the Old Testament. About 2,500 times in scriptures do we find this name for God. 32 times in Genesis chapter 1. The Elohim emphasizes the power of God, the power to create, but it also emphasizes the transcendence of God, the fact that he exists above and independent of his creation. When it tells us in the beginning God, it is reminding us that God is not dependent upon his creation, nor is God limited by his creation. What that means for us is that there's a whole lot of beauty there, is that God's presence is not limited in any form or fashion. That God is eternal. He was there before creation, and he will be there as we dwell with him in heaven, made possible by his Son. There is beauty in God's presence. And Zephaniah 3:17 says this, "The Lord your God is in your midst. He's a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness, and he will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing." We have a heavenly Father who's always been there. And there's nothing in his created world that can ever change that for you and I. And he is not limited by the world in which he's created. There's beauty because God is there. But there's also beauty in God's power. When I was growing up, some of our favorite toys to play with were building toys. And in our household, we had constructs. I don't know if anybody ever remembers constructs. They're kind of like plastic beams you would build with and connect. We had Lincoln logs that we could build with. And I realize now that my family ran a big scam on us for a long time because we had fake Legos. I don't know if anybody ever grew up with fake Legos, but our fake Legos, they came in this big plastic white container. They came in a whole variety of three colors, and I think probably two or three sizes. They were red, white, and blue. And we'd have this big container, and we had those containers forever. They're still about the same size as a Lego. But our family did something where they convinced us that real Legos were bad, that these Legos were the best. They even said, now I was thinking about today, they told us, they said, "You don't want those real Legos. They're real hard to take apart." Well, that's true, partly because they're made really well. They stick together. They're like, these Legos, they're easy to take apart because they just fall apart. You know, but for years, we went around thinking, we do not want Legos for Christmas. You know? They kind of ran a scam on us. But we would love to build. And it seemed like there was constantly, when we were younger, somebody building something. All the pieces would spread out over the living room floor, and there'd be either vehicles or houses or buildings that we would put together. All those pieces, snap it into place. And as much fun as it was to build, in order for us to build, we had to start with something. We were not able to create something from nothing. But in creation, we see the power of God and the fact that he can create something from nothing. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. When God created this world, we see the power and the fact that he did not have to go into a storehouse or a craft room full of items in order to make the planet we live on come together. He created something from nothing. The Hebrew writer says in Hebrews 11:3, he describes it this way. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that is what is seen, was not made out of what is visible. The Hebrew writer says that God formed everything out of nothing. That he didn't put together things that were already there to create a world, but instead he had the power to create something from nothing. We think about the creativity that God had. That's why we're creative, because we're made in the image of God. But even as creative as we can be, we do not have the ability to create something from nothing. And we're just simply reusing what God has already created. We keep using the same parts of his original creation. And not only did he create the world, but he created it in a way that it can be sustained by the work of the Spirit. We see the power of God in the beauty in which he's created this world. He's able to create something from nothing. And to do it, he was able to speak it into existence. There's a court hearing that took place one day. And after the court hearing, the lawyer had walked out with his client. And as they got outside the courthouse, the lawyer finally turned to his client and he said, "Listen, I've got a question for you. Now that you've been acquitted of this crime, will you be honest with me? Did you really steal the car?" The client, in hearing the question, kind of hemmed and hawed for a little bit. And finally looked at the lawyer and he said, "You know, after hearing your amazing argument in court this morning, I'm beginning to think maybe I didn't steal that car." That lawyer might have been a great speaker. And we've probably all been caught up in the power of different people's words, whether it's a great speech or maybe in a courtroom, or somebody in your family. But our words are limited in power. God's words are not. That's one of the most amazing things here we find about God, is that he speaks things into existence. In Genesis 1, he says, "Let there be light," and there was light. And we find that this cycle play over and over throughout the creation account, is God decrees it. And then we find a statement letting us know that it happened, and then a statement describing it. So God decreed it, "Let there be light." Then it tells us, "And there was light." And then we find the comment on it that says, "And it was good." It meant that it was happening according to its purpose. And over throughout the creation account, we find this played out for us, that God can speak it and it happens. In verse 6, he says, "Let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water." So God made a vault and separated water from water, and it was so. God said it and it happened, and he declares it as being so or being good. God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to the various kinds." God says, "Let there be vegetation." There was vegetation. In verse 20, it says, "Let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures. Let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens." So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw it and said, "It is good." We find over and over, God says it, it's accomplished, and it meets its purpose. It's good, or it was so, even when it comes down to God creating us. In verse 26, it says, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heaven, over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on earth." So God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. What we find, why this is so important and so beautiful at the same time, is that God spoke it, and it happened. It reveals not only the power of God, but the purpose of God. This world, you and I, were not created by chance or by accident, but instead were created by a deliberate act from God, who wanted to create this world, and not only created but wanted to sustain it. That's why he spoke it into existence. That is why it was accomplished. And God had the power to create simply by speaking. And his word went forth, and his creation was accomplished. And it is an incredibly beautiful thing for us to think about the power that God had in that moment. He also had the power to create quickly. A number of years ago, I think we shared before, after church on a Sunday morning, a group of us went up to an extreme home makeover build that was taking place in Waleska. And I think out of everybody that went, I think it was only Mandy that made it on the television. But we go up there and we kind of get bussed into this site. And you go there and you realize right away that in order for this house to be remodeled in a week, it happens very, 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 very quickly. Everything is rushed. I remember standing in the house and all of a sudden there's this ruckus coming through. And these guys are kind of moving everybody out of the way as they come rushing in. They're like, "Get out of the way, out of the way, out of the way." The inspector was coming. He looked at one thing. He's like, "Yep, signed off. He's gone." And they start another project. And the whole project went like that. The only time things slowed down is when the celebrities would come out of their trailer, walk over, put a nail in, and then walk away. Yeah, that was when things slowed down. The rest of the time, everything was just rushed so that they could get this house remodeled in a week. And we watched it on TV. You know, I used to love the show. And it's so impressive of what they were able to do in a week. And as quick as it was, it doesn't begin to compare of what God did in 6 days. Nobody can create anything as quickly as God. Look at verse 5 of Genesis 1. It said, God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening and there was morning the first day. Now, as we read that, there's a couple things I think we need to draw our attention to. The first is that a Jewish calendar, or Hebrew calendar, operates differently than our calendar. We measure days, that 24-hour period, usually by morning to morning. They didn't. They measured days from sunset to sunset. It's still a 24-hour period. That's why he begins with evening, and there is morning, the first day. We see that play out during Passover and other scriptures in the Bible. So he's talking about this day, evening, morning. But then what we find is the word that's used here for day throughout Genesis chapter 1 is used other places in the Old Testament. It's used over 1,000 times in the Old Testament. And it's always important for us when we see a word used one way in the Bible to see how it's used in other ways to make sure that it's defined or we're using it correctly. Well, the word for day that's used in the Old Testament and used here, over 90% of the time refers to a 24-hour period. But there's something else we have to notice about that. Is why it's over 90% of the time it's used about a 24-hour period. If you put a number in front of it, or a number with it, so there was the first day of creation, or second day of creation. We'll see in a minute where Moses writes about creation, and he uses, I believe it's a 6 day of creation. What we find is that 100% of the time in scriptures, when there's a number in front of the word day, it always refers to a 24-hour period. It doesn't leave room for anything else in understanding. So when it says that there is evening, there is morning the first day, he's talking about a 24-hour period. In Exodus 20:11, Moses, in writing about creation, says, "For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day." What it tells us is that God, who has the power to create something out of nothing, has the power to be able to do it quickly. We admire the power that God has and is revealed throughout nature. If you've ever been to a river and seen how the power and the force of that river over time has cut out of a canyon, or you go and you stand along a beach and you feel the power of the waves as it crashes along the shore, or maybe you've seen somewhere where an eagle takes flight. It was just over Thanksgiving that we were watching two bald eagles fly out over this lake trying to catch some little critter swimming through the lake. And it was amazing to see not only, you know, their acrobatic ability, but to see the power that they had in those wings where they could just take flight like that. If you've ever noticed the power in nature, then stop and notice the power in the one who created all of nature. There's beauty in the power of God, who is able to complete it all of creation quickly and by just speaking. We also see beauty in his authority. Now, this is the point that really began to understand a lot more this week through the commentary on the book of Genesis, as I mentioned earlier, by James Smith. And let's be honest, we usually don't like authority. We usually don't see a whole lot of beauty in authority. If you've ever been pulled over for going too fast, and you see those lights kind of pop up behind you, you don't look back, man, what a beautiful sight. Yeah, and if you ever get brought into a courtroom, you had to stand in front of a judge, you're usually not admiring the beauty of the judge. We tend to not like authority. But in Genesis, in the creation account, we see the beautiful authority that God has. We've already recognized some of it. He has the authority to create, the authority to speak things into creation. But it's more than that. One of the things we see about the authority of God is he has the authority to name his creation. He who gives a name is superior to that which is named. And oftentimes in the ancient world, when somebody went in and conquered a city, that conqueror would give that city a new place. He would give it a new name. And in Genesis chapter 1, as God creates the world, we see him naming aspects of that creation. He names the light and the darkness in 1:5. In 1:8, he names the expanse. In 1:10, he names the gathering of the waters and the dry land. But not only did God have the authority to name, he had the authority to bless. A true blessing always flows from a greater to a lesser. And in Genesis 1, we see God, who's in charge, issuing three blessings. He blesses the fish and the birds on day 5. He blesses man on day 6. And in Genesis 2:3, he blesses the Sabbath, which was day 7. We also recognize his authority to delegate power. God delegated this sovereign power that he had in authority as he gives out responsibility. On day 4, God appointed the greater lights to rule the day and the lesser lights to rule the night. We find on day 6 that man was given dominion over all the earth and the animals that inhabit it. That is why us as God's creation, as mankind, does not worship any creature, because God has put us over all of them. We save our worship for the Creator himself. In creation, we see the beauty and the power of God and the authority that he had, that authority that he could delegate, the authority that he could name, and the authority that he could bless. So we begin to look at creation, and we see so much more than just these days of creation. When we look at creation, we see the beauty of the God who could create all of it from nothing by just speaking. And he's able to bless his creation. And not only does he bless his creation, but he's able to delegate power to his creation. And it all is a reflection of his presence. But if we look at the creation which God has made, maybe the one thing that grabs our attention the most is the beauty in God's creativeness. There's a lot of great works of creativity in our world today. There's a lot of people who've been blessed and gifted with the ability to paint great pictures or sculpt incredible statues, build buildings that just take our breath away when we see it, but nobody has ever been as creative as God. The psalmist describes the creativity of God in this way. In Psalm 104, verse 24, he says, "O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdoms you've made them all. The earth is full of your creatures." When we look at the world around us and we see the diversity in which God has created the world around us, hopefully our reaction is to recognize not only the beauty of his creation, but the beauty of the one who was creative enough to speak it into existence. I was trying to figure out how do we convey that beauty. I thought it'd be really fun to just, you know, fill the fellowship hall with wild animals, but probably not realistic. So I thought the BBC a number of years ago probably had the best example that I've seen. A commercial that they made for one of their nature series that were coming up. And as we talk about the beauty of God's creativeness, let's just take a few minutes and kind of see that beauty and that creativeness unfold.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue, clouds of white, bright, blessed days, dark, sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of a rainbow, so pretty in the sky, also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, "How do you do?" They're really saying, "I love you." I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. they'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Quite simply wonderful.
I love that video, but we realize it's barely the tip of the iceberg of how beautiful our world is. And every time we see the beauty that God's created, let's make sure that we look beyond the creation. See the beauty of a God who could speak it into existence from nothing. The beauty of God's presence, that he was there before creation. And he'll be there with us in a new heaven and a new earth. And how do we react to that beauty? I think in Revelation 4:11, maybe we find the best example. So we find these words. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. Let's always admire the beauty of the one who could create such a beautiful place. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this world that we live in. And we're just amazed by the beauty that constantly surrounds us. But we pray that you'll help us to never get caught up in the beauty of this world and neglect the true beauty that's found in you. So in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Stand with us as we continue to worship.
Thank you.
events in our lives invite us to look both forward and backwards. Graduation, weddings, New Year's, which we just celebrated. And at these times, we consider the significance of the past while we anticipate the future. As we come to the time of the Lord's Supper, it is such one of those events. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26 reads, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." When we worship through participation in communion, we look back at the cross. We are reminded of our sin that made Christ's death necessary. And as we remember the cross, we must face our own unworthiness to receive God's forgiveness and his salvation. And as we search our hearts and take inventory of things that go on in our lives, we confess our sins and our failures to the Lord. Partaking in the cup prompts us to express thanks to God for the blessing of his grace and mercy, and we realize that our Lord is present with us in this moment as we partake. We also look forward during this time, and we declare our confident expectation that Christ is coming back for each and every one of his children. And even though the second coming is a future event, it influences our present. Speaking of our hope in Christ, 1 John 3:3 says, "Everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure." As we share in our communion time today, we remember the past, we anticipate the future, and we experience renewal in the present. The cross is not some dusty artifact of history, but it's a dynamic of the present and the future. We remember our Lord who died, yet he's not dead. He lives and he will return to proclaim his own. We have a living hope because we have a living Lord. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, as we come to our time of communion, we celebrate the fact that you did go to the cross so that one day we may be with you, that we have a hope of a future in your presence. We love you and we praise you in your mighty name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year. I think I can speak for a fair amount of us parents when I say that most days are very chaotic and we feel successful when we've simply survived the day. Most of the time we get so caught up in running our kids from one activity to the next that oftentimes we pay little to no attention to what's important. Stop for a minute and ask yourself, where do you think your kid is going to be when he or she is 20? What character traits is she going to have? What will his opinion be of the world around him? What will she believe? And will she love and know who God is? As a parent, you are the greatest spiritual influence in your kid's life. And the answer to those questions can be positively impacted by spending time as a family in God's Word. That's one of the reasons that we are so excited about Core 52. This kid's book provides a family task every day that's similar to the adult book. For example, on day one, there is an essay to read, which if you have kids that read, they can read that aloud. Day two is memorizing the scripture, which you're supposed to do in the adult book so they can just do it with you. And side note, they're gonna be better at it than you are. Day three is to read Genesis 1 this week, and there's some questions that go with it. Day four is another scripture reading and more questions. And then day five, there's some questions for your kid to ask of you and vice versa. Any of this can be done on the way to school, on the way home from school, at the dinner table, or even before bed. This year, make spending time in God's Word as a family a priority. Have a great week.
Over the last couple of years, our family's been able to do a little bit of traveling, and one of the things that happens is when you travel, you're able to see just different things. And I think about growing up, or now when we go down to Florida to visit our family, you know, you go out to the beach, and it seems like just the beach, the water, the sky, it's like God just painted that or drew that out with kind of pastel colors. And then you come up here, and you look at the mountains, and it's like he just took some paint and just painted these incredible mountains all around us. And then a few years ago, we went out west. It's like he put aside some of the pastels or some of the paint, and it's almost like he just carved out those incredible cliffs and canyons and things out there. And you look at that, and you just marvel at the beauty of God, the beauty in which he created this world. This summer, we were traveling to Pennsylvania, and as we were doing so, Isaac, who is he's our youngest son, he was 15 at the time, we're driving along, you'd look out the window, and we were admiring some mountains or some rivers we're driving across, and he'd say, "See that?" We're like, "Yeah, we see that." He goes, "My friend made that." And I'm thinking, "You have lost your mind." And we're like, what are you talking about? He goes, "You know my friend." I said, "What friend?" He's like, "Jesus." We're like, "All right." And the whole trip, that's what he'd keep going to. Everything he said, "My friend made that." Every time we made a comment, "My friend made that." And maybe sometimes I should be more like that. That we don't just get caught up in the beautiful scene, but we remember who made it. But more than that, I hope every time you see something of beauty in creation, you don't just admire the beauty of the creation, you admire the beauty of the Creator. The beauty of his power to be able to speak it into existence from nothing, create something, and something so incredible. The power to do it quickly. That when you see the beautiful creation all around us, you remember that before that creation came, one of the most beautiful things is that God was there, and he will be there even as we long and wait for that new creation to come down and for us to be able to dwell with him in heaven. And I hope that is just the beginning of the journey, is that we begin to not only see God's beauty in the world that he's created and the beauty that he had in order to be able to create that, but we begin to see the beauty that just unfolds throughout his word. Because as we look through his word and we look through our life with him, we see over and over just how beautiful our Savior is. I mean, we think about the fact that God's a holy God, but yet he has enough grace to rescue us who are sinners. That Jesus, who is the Word made flesh, and all things were created through, comes to his creation to die for the sins of those he's created. We see beauty in the cross and beauty in the empty tomb. We see beauty in his word as it unfolds. We can get caught up in all the little stories sometimes, all the characters, but if we just step back, we see beauty in this whole book that God's given to us through guiding the writers through the Holy Spirit, that unveil and show us just how beautiful God is. He reveals himself to us so that we can know him, so that we can marvel in his beauty. We begin to see beauty in the body of Christ. Different people, different talents, different abilities all coming together to honor the Lord and to encourage one another. We see beauty. We see beauty in the Lord's Supper every week. We see beauty in baptism, not because we're getting wet, but because of the work of the Lord in us and through us. We see beauty in the hope that we have of one day dwelling in the presence of God and living forever in the true place of beauty. When we recognize not just the beauty in the works of God, but we recognize the beauty in God, it transforms the way we live. It changes our gratitude. It fires up our worship. It makes us passionate to share the beauty of God with those around us, so they can see what we see. And today, as we close out this service, during this final song, let's just express our love to God. And if you don't know the beautiful God who's created you, who saves you, who strengthens you, then during this song, we invite you to come forward. Maybe you come forward just because we need to talk, or maybe you grab me at the door because we need to talk and learn more about this beautiful Lord who loves you so much. If you have a decision to make, we invite you to come forward as we stand and sing. Just a quick reminder, tonight, young adults, we're meeting down in the fellowship hall, young adult college age, at 6 p.m. And Wednesday nights, classes, youth groups, dinner, it all starts back. Information's in the bulletin, but 6 o'clock for dinner, 7 o'clock for classes. And also, man, Core 52, we're so excited about that. I hope that you join us as we grow in knowledge, and growing in knowledge, it just transforms our faith and our trust in this incredible Savior we have. And if you haven't picked up a book, they're available in the foyer. Grab those. If you're not on our email, please be sure to scan that QR code, get signed up so you can start getting the email tomorrow morning that will help outline this whole week. But I am just confident that this next year, that as we grow together in God's Word, it's going to transform us, and it's going to transform all of us together. Let's pray. God, you truly are the beautiful one. And the world that you've created is just a reflection, a small reflection of just how beautiful you really are. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your creativity and your authority. And we thank you that even though there is none like you, that you love us. And we pray that you'll help us to continually remember just how beautiful you are. So in your son's name we pray. Amen.